I'm so glad he knows the way through the wilderness. Amen. 441 together. Let's all stand as we sing. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me. 441 on that first together. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me. And with the sunlight of his love bid all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Though clouds may gather in the sky and billows around me roll, however dark the world may be, I've sunlight in my soul. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Let's sing that last. Soon I shall see him as he is, the light that came to me. Behold the brightness of his face throughout eternity. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within.
Amen. All right, good singing. Good to see everybody in church tonight. Boy, what a beautiful day today was, wasn't it? And just great. And good morning this morning. Thankful for BJ following the Lord in baptism and the Van Sickles becoming members of the church. And just a great, great day. And good to be in church tonight. Thanks for making your way here. Let's bow together for prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer this evening. We thank you for Sunday night church. Thank you, Lord, for the many, many times you've spoken to my heart through the years because I was in church on Sunday night. Many decisions I made in my life was because I was in church on Sunday night. And so, Lord, I pray that you'll meet with us here this evening. Lord, everyone's made the effort to be here and to be in their place. And, Father, I pray that your will would be done in each one of our hearts and lives. May you be pleased with the service tonight. May it be exactly what you would want it to be. And I simply ask you to use it in our lives to help us, to strengthen us, to draw us closer to you. And I'll pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Number 89, if you would turn with me, please. Number 89, I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, but I've got a mansion over the hilltop. Let's sing that first together. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below.
Yeah.
right, good singing. Now some announcements for us. Listen carefully, if you will. And remember, at the close of the service tonight, we're going to need some help, and we're going to empty this auditorium, all right? All the chairs out, the table out, everything, because they're going to come in tomorrow morning to start tearing the carpet out and getting ready to put the new down. Now, I think what we'll do is we have cleared the conference room, so we'll start there with stacking the chairs. I would try to not to go more than four chairs stacked. If you start going more than that, it starts to bend a little bit, and I don't want to bend any of the legs or anything like that. So if someone can make sure that they stay no more than four stacked, and we'll just line them up in the conference room and then come out into the foyer area. I don't think we'll get them on the foyer area without anybody getting through there, all right? So we'll try to fill the conference room up and then come over this way. And if you come across any broken chairs, loose, the cushions loose or missing a screw or something like that, then we want you to set that aside or get it to Don Taylor's attention. He's going to fix every one of those chairs, okay, and make sure they're put back into service, all right? So Warren Storm keeps the buses rolling. Don Taylor's going to keep the chairs sitting or something, all right? And he's going to keep those chairs in service, all right? So that'll be great. Oh, I see here, let's see. He's going to fix them Monday and Tuesday. He says, any men wanting to help, he'll be here around 8:30 in the morning, okay? So if you're willing to help him out with those fixing the chairs, you can do that, all right? So we'll clear this auditorium out. I tell you what we probably should do, though, is, by the way, that includes the choir chairs have to go out. Would it be easier to get the books out of them? Before we start, they're going to fall out mostly anyway. Probably will, when we're done, if we now get all the books out, we'll, I think we can stack the books in this room. And I think there's room there to just make several stacks of books. You can go as high as you want on those without them falling over, okay? And have fun with that, and then we can carry the chairs without worrying about the books falling out. Okay, a couple of you men will probably have to kind of empty that cabinet and carry the cabinet as well. Okay, everything, we want to make it to where all the carpeted area, the little table, the lamps, all that stuff will have to go. Okay, all right. Then we'll get everything back in here on Wednesday, Lord willing. If you're available at all on Wednesday, please come. During the daytime, we'll try to get all the chairs back in here and get us set up for Wednesday night service, and that would be great. And then regular time Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, the Glow Club, which are the older children, they're going to be singing Wednesday night in the service, and so you want to make sure you're here for that. That's always a treat when they sing for us, and they'll be part of the Wednesday night service. Then Thursday night, we'll kick off the missions conference, 6:30 Thursday night, 6:30 Friday night. Okay, and then 5 o'clock on Saturday for the international dinner. Many of you signed up this morning. I saw that. That's great. If you haven't signed up yet, get your name on the list for Saturday night. And then 5 o'clock, we start that meal. And then afterwards, we come in here for the service, and that's when they afterwards they get their gifts that you've purchased for them. And that's always just a great night. And we look forward to Saturday night, and then, of course, right into next Sunday. So it's going to be a great, great conference. We're looking forward to that. Saturday, also in the morning, is the Arts in the Alley Parade, and you're welcome to come. Walk along with that. Pass out the John and Romans. Throw some candy. And we'd love to have you along for that as well. And I think we'll let you know for sure Wednesday night, but plan on 9 a.m. To head down to the parade, okay? I think that's... the ladies' conference we announced this morning down at Heritage Baptist Church in Kanawha, Winchester. That's October 14 and 15. Again, if you're interested in that, there's literature about that on the table downstairs. And I think it's $25 for the ladies, $20 for teenagers. And you can get that money to Lindy, and she'll get it into them. Everything has to be in by October 2nd, and they can only have 175 ladies. So you want to get that in as soon as you can. All right. I think that's all I've got right now. We'll take a moment and welcome any guests we have with us tonight. Brother Doug, you got a guest with you. Great. Good to have you tonight, my friend. Glad you come to be with us in church this evening. Usher is going to hand you a welcome card there. If you'll be kind enough to just fill that card out for us, we'd appreciate that. We'll have a record of your visit with us this evening, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming tonight, all right? Glad you're here. All right. And Nazra is back there. She's right there. She's a friend of Leland and a co-worker, and glad that she came tonight as well. All right. Thank you for being here. All right. And, oh, want to pray for Joy. Tomorrow morning is her surgery. And she has to be there, I think, at 6 a.m. So normally that means 7:30, 8 o'clock surgery, something like that, providing no other emergencies come in or anything like that. So keep Joy in your prayers in the morning, all right? And all will go well with that. And I'm sure it will, but that's always an apprehensive time. So keep her in prayer in the morning, all right? Okay, let's give our guests a warm welcome, shall we?
Number 249 with you. Turn with me, please. 249. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Let's sing that verse together. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. After I'd wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Shadow dispelling with joy, I am telling, he made all the darkness depart. And glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away. And my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above into God's family divine. Justified fully through Calvary's love, oh, what a standing is mine. And the transaction so quickly was made when as a sinner I came. Took the offer of grace he did proper. He saved me, oh, praise his dear name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime, and it's because of that wonderful day. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from his precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. We have another one, don't we? Well, why don't we sing it then? How about going to 538? That just seemed like something to end on. 538. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme. Blessed be the name. Let's all stand together as we sing. 538 together on that first. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme. Who gave his son for men to die that he might men redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name above all names shall stand exalted more. Be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's all greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last together. Thank you. Helper, Savior, friend of men, once ruined by the fall. Thou hast devised salvation plan, for thou hast died for all. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. Let's sing that last together. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. Of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, whose reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
All right, good singing. You can be seated. Ushers are coming to get our offering. I should have said earlier, too, the younger children are going to be singing as well. So I left them out. How about that? The Pee Wee Patch Club. They'll be singing Wednesday night also, all right? And we'll look forward to that, okay? All right, let's pray, and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering tonight. Brother Andy, lead us in our prayer.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for another opportunity to be in your house tonight, and don't want to take that for granted. And again, we just want to take a moment and remember the families of the victims of 9/11. Just pray that you would send your comfort over them and their families today as they remember that horrific event in our country's history, Lord. Lord, I pray that you'd be at the offering now as we take it. I pray that you'd help us to be cheerful givers tonight, knowing we're investing in your kingdom. What a privilege that is. Thank you, God, for that opportunity. I pray that you'd be with pastor as we open the word after this, that you would help us to be attentive and spirit-filled listeners tonight. And we'll thank you and give you all the praise and glory, for it's in your name I pray. Amen.
Take your Bible this evening, if you would, to Luke chapter 7 for our scripture reading tonight. Luke chapter 7, please. Luke 7, we are going to read the first 9 verses of Luke chapter 7. And we read them responsively. We begin together on verse 1, and I'll read 2, and we'll alternate until we end together on verse number 9 of Luke chapter 7. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 1. Ready? Now when he had ended all his sayings in the audience of the people, he entered into Capernaum. And a certain centurion's servant, who was dear unto him, was sick and ready to die. And when he heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching him that he would come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they besought him instantly, saying that he was worthy for whom he should do this. For he loveth our nation, and he hath built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them. And when he was now not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying unto him, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou shouldest enter under my roof. Therefore neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but say in a word, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man set under authority, having under me soldiers. And I say unto one, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turned him about, and said unto the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. And let's pray, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this evening. Lord, I want to thank you for the Bible. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to hold copies in our hands tonight. And Lord, I pray that you would prepare our hearts so we'd be ready to receive the truth from your word this evening. Lord, I pray that you'd keep us from distraction and that you'd help us to focus even on the special as it's sung. And that, Lord, we would ask you to tune our heart to your heart tonight, that we might hear what the Spirit would say to his church this evening. And I pray you'll bless the special to that end. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
We've a story to tell to the nations that shall turn their hearts to the right. A story of truth and mercy, a story of peace and light. A story of peace and light. We've a song to be sung to the nations that shall lift their hearts to the Lord. A song that shall conquer evil. A song that will conquer seer, spear, and sword, and shatter the spear and sword. We've a message to give to the nations that the Lord who reigneth above hath sent us his Son to save us and show us that God is love, and show us that God is love. We've a Savior to show to the nations who the path of sorrow hath trod, that all of the world's great peoples might come to the truth of God, might come to the truth of God. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, and the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come to earth, the kingdom of love and light.
Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer as we come to the preaching of your word tonight. And Father, I pray that you'll give me your help as I bring the message this evening, and please do help the people as they listen tonight. And Father, I pray that you would help us to grasp the truth that's contained here in the scripture this evening. Open our understanding as only you can as we look into your word tonight. And again, Lord, I ask you that your will would be done in each heart and life, that you would do a work in the hearts that only you can do, and that some decisions be made for thee tonight that will make you marvel. So, Father, bless this time together in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Keep your Bible open at Luke chapter 7. I'm going to have you turn to some other scriptures here in just a few minutes. You'll use your Bible tonight. You know, about 24 years ago, we took a big family vacation. Our children were obviously much younger then, and we took a trip over to Philadelphia and saw the historical things in Philadelphia, including the Liberty Bell and Independence Hall. We went to Washington, D.C., and took a tour of the White House and saw the different things in Washington to see, and went to New York City. Included that in that vacation. And I remember standing for my first time on Ellis Island there, looking at the Statue of Liberty and just marveling at that. And just being a part of what I think is history of all the folks that have entered our country through that harbor, and what that Lady Liberty means standing there, marveling. That was just an amazing sight to me to see. I kind of felt that way the first time I saw the Grand Canyon. How many have been to the Grand Canyon? Quite a few of you. How many have never been to the Grand Canyon? Oh my, oh my. Pictures do not do it justice at all. Boy, you see that, it just takes your breath away. I can't imagine being the first settlers who were pushing west and coming upon this. It would just be, you just would marvel at what God had done. And this past summer, we took a trip up and we were in the Boston area and Plymouth Rock area. And I stood and marveled at what's called the Monument to Our Forefathers. It's an amazing monument. Most people have not heard of it. There's some of you. How many have not heard of the Monument to the Forefathers? You've not heard of it. Yeah, about half the crowd. It's an amazing piece. And it's amazing. When we went there, we got there. I think my wife and I went to see it. We drove into the parking lot. It might have been around 3:45 in the afternoon. And we're the only ones there. I mean, it's a phenomenal piece, and I just again found myself just kind of marveling at this work of art, and the words that are inscribed on this is just phenomenal. If you ever have opportunity to see it, I kind of felt the same way when I was on the Mayflower. Now, I wasn't on it. The other day, the electricians were here, and they were, "How long has this church been here?" 61 years. And I always have to remind them, I have not been the pastor all that time. Just getting to be that age, I tell you. I knew I was getting older. The time that I when I was leaving the barber shop one time, and another fellow was coming in, and he held the door open for me, and I said, "Thank you." He said, "You're welcome, sir." I knew I've passed the line. And I'm an old man now, so. But I marvel at that Mayflower ship and how all those people lived there and stayed in such small quarters. That was amazing to me. Now, as we marvel at things that God has done, and that's not unusual, and I want to look at some scriptures tonight where we see that people, it was not unusual for them to marvel at Jesus Christ. Oftentimes, he did things on earth that had never been done before. They saw him do things that were just amazing to them, and they would marvel at him. So take your Bible. Let's start in Matthew, all right? Let's start in Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. Matthew 8, Jesus has gotten into a ship, and his disciples are following him. And in verse number 24 of Matthew 8, it says, "There arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch the ship was covered with waves, but he was asleep. And the disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, Why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose, rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men did what, church? Marveled. They marveled, saying, What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him?" They'd never seen anything like that before. I mean, wake him up, he just speaks to the storm and says, it's stop or peace be still. And man, everything stopped and it was calm. I'm sure they looked at each other and said, wow. Never saw anything like that before. Look in the next chapter, chapter 9. Matthew 9. Verse number 32. As they went out, behold, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with a devil. And when the devil was cast out, the dumb spake. And the multitudes marveled, saying, it was never so seen in Israel. Now, when it says a dumb man, I know some of you women think, are there any other kind? But it's not talking about smarts, okay? This is someone who couldn't speak and he's demon-possessed. And Jesus just simply cast him out and all of a sudden the fellow could talk. They thought, wow. We've never seen that happen before. They marveled at what Jesus could do. Look at Matthew 21. Go with me to Matthew chapter 21. Here Jesus is with his disciples. It says, in the morning, verse number 18, he returned to the city, he hungered, and when he saw, verse 19, a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing thereon but leaves only, and said unto it, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. And presently the fig tree withered away. When the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, how soon is the fig tree withered away? Jesus wants to get some fruit off the fig tree. There's no fruit there. He said, why are you cumbering the ground? You can just go ahead and die. And the thing shrivels up right there on the spot. That's pretty amazing. They'd never seen anybody do that before. And they marveled at Jesus. Let's look at Matthew 27. Matthew chapter 27. This is Jesus before Pilate. Verse number 13. Then said Pilate unto him, hearest thou not how many things they witness against thee? And he answered him to never a word. Insomuch that the governor, that's Pilate, did what? Marveled greatly. All these people casting things at Jesus and saying things, and we find out later, falsely accusing him, saying false things against him, and yet Jesus never answers a word. Pilate marveled at that. Because it's just the natural thing to want to defend yourself. Especially when you've been convicted of a crime. So Pilate marveled. Now I want you to look at Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. Mark 2 is a great story of a paralytic man, a paralyzed man, who is... Four friends get him to where Jesus is so he can be healed. This is the story where they break up the roof and let the guy down through a hole in the roof so he can be saved. And of course, Jesus said, sons, thy sins be forgiven thee. And then some of the scribes are sitting there reasoning in their hearts saying he's speaking blasphemy because nobody can forgive sins but God only. But Jesus could forgive his sin because Jesus is God. And so He says, what's easier, verse 9, to say to the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, arise, take up thy bed and walk, but that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins. And he saith to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise, and take up thy bed, and go thy way into thine house. And immediately he arose, and took up the bed, and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed. That's another way of saying they all marveled. And they glorified God, saying, we never saw it on this fashion. We've never seen it like this. We've never seen anybody do that. Now go with me to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, if you would please. Again, this has to do with an unclean spirit, an unclean devil. Here is the Bible calls it. In the synagogue, Luke 4 and verse 33, in the synagogue there was a man which had a spirit of an unclean devil and cried out with a loud voice, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God. Jesus rebuked him, saying, hold thy peace and come out of him. When the devil had thrown him in the midst, he came out of him and hurt him not. And they were all amazed. They marveled at Jesus and spake among themselves, what a word is this? For with authority and power he commandeth the unclean spirits, and they come out. Never saw somebody who speak and things would happen. They never saw anything like that. He could speak the word and the wind and the storm would cease. He could speak the word and the fig tree would wither up and die. Here he speaks the word and an unclean spirit. Again, they could do nothing with unclean spirits. The maniac, they tried to chain him, remember? That's all they knew to do, try to contain him, and he just bust them loose. They didn't know what to do with him. Jesus would just speak the word and they'd have to leave. They couldn't believe his authority in the way he spoke. That's why, remember they said he spoke as one having authority and not as one of the scribes. That's what they're talking about. And then, if you will, look at John chapter 4. John chapter 4, we have the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, sometimes as she's known. And Jesus' encounter with her and leading her to faith in him. He says in verse number 25, the woman said, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he's come, he'll tell us all things. And Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. And about that time, his disciples came, and they marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, what seekest thou, or why talkest thou with her? They marveled that Jesus would witness to this lady, that he would even talk to her, because the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans, and certainly a Jewish man would have no dealing with a Samaritan woman. But he goes to show her that, listen, everybody needs the gospel. Everybody ought to know who Jesus is. And he gives the gospel to this lady and she's saved. Now, it's not only in the scripture. We sing, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Or there's a song in our book that we don't sing necessarily as a congregation, but it's called I Stand Amazed. I stand amazed of the love that has bought me, or sought me, saved me, and bought me. I stand amazed. You ever just been amazed at Jesus Christ? You ever just marveled that he would love you enough to save your soul and forgive your sin and to write your name in heaven? He's worthy to be marveled at. Jesus is worthy to be amazed at. He's an unbelievable God. So I see the disciples marveled at him at times. You'll read how Joseph and Mary marveled at what was said about him. Pilate marveled at him. The Pharisees marveled at him. The woman at the well marveled. The disciples marveled. Hey, the multitudes at times marveled at him. And rightfully so. No one ever spake like this man spake. No one ever did what they saw him do. No one ever walked like he walked. No one ever taught like he taught. No one ever did what he had done. I'm not surprised that they marveled at him. That doesn't surprise me at all. There's times we marvel as well. But when you go to Luke chapter 7, where we were tonight and the scripture we read tonight, we have an entirely different story here. It's an entirely different scenario. Here we have a centurion with a sick servant. And as Jesus, he sends servants to go tell Jesus about his servant. And as Jesus is coming to where this man is, he sends another group of servants to say, tell Jesus he doesn't have to come here. He can just speak the word and my servant can be healed. He said, listen, I understand authority. I have servants under me. I have soldiers under me. I tell this guy go and he goes. I tell this guy come here and he comes here. I tell this guy do this and he does that. All Jesus has to do is speak the word and my servant can be healed. And Jesus stops. And I don't know if Jesus said wow or not. But he could have, because you know what he said? He said this, verse 9. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him. Wow. Jesus marveled at the centurion. Why? He said, he said to the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in all Israel. He's amazed at this man's faith. He's amazed that he grasps the power of Jesus' word. That he knows he can just speak the word and his servant will be made whole. He understands that the evil spirit that may be affecting his servant is subjected to the authority of Jesus. The divine marvels at the human. The sinless one marvels at the sinful one. The strong marvels at the weak. God marveling at man. Jesus said, I've not found so great faith. And the Bible says in verse 10, they that were sent returning to the house found the servant whole that had been sick. I don't know about you, but as you read a story like that, does it ever occur to you, does it ever enter into your heart or your mind that, boy, it would be kind of neat to make Jesus marvel? I'd like to be in that crowd. I'd like to be one of those people that could make Jesus marvel. Would it be amazing if Jesus would ever just look at you and say, you're amazing that you have that kind of faith in me? That's amazing. So great faith. Someone said, if I show little faith, God is pleased. If I show faith, God is very pleased. If I show great faith, God is very happy. But when I show so great faith, God marvels. He marvels. Now, the amazing statement is, he said, I've not seen so great faith, no, not in all Israel. This is a Roman centurion. This is the heathen guy. And God says he has more faith than all of Israel. Now, if anybody should have had faith, it should have been Israel. Somebody in Israel should have had the great faith. Isn't it Israel that saw the miracles of God? Isn't it Israel that God delivered him by the plagues out of Egypt, including the death of the firstborn? And then when he led them out, he parted the Red Sea so that they went through on dry ground. And then the Egyptians, when they tried to chase them through, God brought the water back down, drowned them all. They saw, hey, didn't God miraculously lead them by a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day? When the cloud stopped and they set up camp and they didn't move till the cloud began to move or the pillar of fire moved. Didn't God give them manna to eat every morning? Didn't God bring water from a rock? Not water from a well, water from a rock. And God, he didn't just give water to a few people. Somewhere it all varies, 1.5 million to maybe 2.5 million people. I don't remember what the last time I heard the greater Columbus area here, including the suburbs and everything, 1.7 million people. You ever think about all the water that gets used in just one day? And God did that day after day after day. If anybody should have had great faith in God, it should have been somebody in Israel. But God said, it's this Roman. He had so great faith. Now, I want you to look at Matthew chapter 14. Little different message for us tonight, but I'm heading somewhere with it. Won't have the normal 3 points or 4 points for you, but I think it'll be a blessing. Matthew 14. In Matthew 14 and verse number 15, this is the recording of the feeding of the 5,000. It talks about when the evening, his disciples came to him saying, this is a desert place, the time is now past. Send the multitude away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves victuals. Jesus said unto them, they need not depart, give ye them to eat. But they say unto him, we have here but 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He said, bring them hither to me. He commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass, took the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, and looking up to heaven, he blessed and brake and gave the loaves to his disciples, the disciples to the multitude, and they did all eat and were filled. They took up of the fragments that remained 12 basketfuls. And they that had eaten were about 5,000 men beside women and children. Now, it doesn't say anybody marveled here, but it should have been amazing to me. To see everybody eat and still have leftovers, okay? Now, when you go to the next chapter, in chapter 15, beginning in verse number 32, again, Jesus calls his disciples unto him and said, I have compassion on the multitude. They continue with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I will not send them away fasting, lest they faint in the way. And his disciples say unto him, whence shall we have so much bread in the wilderness as to fill so great a multitude? He said, well, how many loaves have ye? And they said, 7 and a few little fishes. Now, I don't know about you, but if I just saw him take care of 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, this should have been, I should have easily known what he was going to do. I said, Lord, we got plenty. We got 7 loaves this time, all right? But he commanded the multitude to sit down on the ground. He took the 7 loaves and the fishes, gave thanks, brake them, gave his disciples to the multitude. And they did all eat and were filled. And they took up the broken meat, was left 7 baskets full. And they that did eat were 4,000 men beside women and children. So we have the feeding of the 5,000 and the feeding of the 4,000. And that's just the men they counted, not counting the women and the children. But now I want you to look in chapter 16. Isn't the Bible an amazing book? It's amazing what you learn if you just read the Bible. And here it is in chapter 16. Now, Jesus says in verse number 6, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they reason among themselves, saying, it's because we've taken no bread. Which when Jesus perceived, he said unto them, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves because ye have brought no bread? Now look, do ye not yet understand, neither remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000 and how many baskets ye took up? Neither the 7 loaves of the 4,000 and how many baskets ye took up? How is it you do not understand that I spake it not to you concerning bread, that you should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees? Then understood they how he bade them not to beware of the leaven of the bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. But do ye not understand, he said, nor remember. The one reason that oftentimes it's so difficult for us to exercise the faith in God we ought to is we do not remember. Just as Israel didn't remember all that God had done for them, we're so prone to forget what God has done for us. God's done some amazing things. I remember when we began to first raise money to renovate this auditorium for the first time. How many were here when that happened? 2009. Several of you were here. That was a big order, man. That was huge. The first thing we did was not long after we came, we got rid of the rainbow windows. Okay? And we got updated windows. And they were old, the old aluminum type windows. I mean, in summer you feel the heat coming in, in winter you feel the cold coming in. They just weren't real efficient at all, and they were all different colors. And so, but that was going to be $4,000. I think it took us about 9 months to collect that money. That was a rough deal. And we came to that was probably in maybe 2006, maybe 2007. Come 2009, we want to do the auditorium. And that was going to be, how much was that, Bob? $12,000, $13,000, something like that? Like, okay, that'll take us, let's see, 9 months for $4,000, 18 months, 27 months maybe. You know, it'll take us 2-3 years to get that up there. And so we just set the start giving, and then we were going to raise money. Somehow it seems it was December. And somebody came to me, totally, and this is the way God has always done it, totally unexpected, totally the someone who you'd never look and say, well, yeah, they could pay for this. No. It's somebody you'd never guess, you'd never know. God uses the most unusual, unlikely people to give. Somebody came and said, they're going to match whatever people give in the month of December. And I think in that month or that 6-week period there, we got the $6,500 and they put $6,500 with it. We had $13,000. We renovated the auditorium. You know what? I don't want to forget that. I want to remember that. I want to remember what God did. Remember how God provides. I thought about our missionaries, and when we came here, 17 people voted us in to be the pastor. At that time, the church, Brother Wallace was here, the church had 25 missionaries they were committed to support at $25 a month. Now, they weren't always getting that, because 17 people, you're just trying to keep the doors open and keep things going. And so we had to start trying to make sure we can support those missionaries. And then as God began to bless and God began to grow the church, and, you know, we didn't cut back the missionaries. We continued to add missionaries. And now, I don't even know how many missionaries we support. Do you know, Miss Taylor? 66 missionaries? We got to change that. I don't like that number. And six missionaries, yeah. And you know, somebody asked me the other day, how can we keep adding missionaries? And by the way, most of the missionaries now, we support at $50 a month. We still have some at $35. I'd like to get them all up to $50. And some we do more than $50. But most are that way. And you say, how can you take on more missionaries? Because we have to take on more missionaries. Because we're going to get the gospel to the ends of the earth. And that's the heart of God. I think that I was relating the other night, actually I read yesterday in the conference that Brother Bowman had, how 5 years ago, how God started the RU ministry here. We had been burdened about the RU ministry, and God put on our heart, we need to reach the addicted of this area. There's a great need for that in Columbus. And by the way, the need's greater tonight than it was 5 years ago. And needed $1,105 to start that ministry that we did not have, okay? Didn't have it to start it. And we began to pray and just waiting on God to provide that money somehow. And I got a phone call at the church here on a Friday, and it was Mr. Williams from next door, Kirk Williams Company. And he was saying they had a big project they're working on. They're going to have semi-trailers to store things in, and they need somewhere to park those trailers. and that extra land back here behind our parking lot between the shed and our semi-trailer, could they park trailers in there? I don't think we had the trailer back there then. And he said, how much would you rent that land to me for 6 weeks to park these trailers? And I remember telling him, I said, I have no idea how much to rent that for. He goes, Pastor, you couldn't tell me a number that would surprise me. Man, I should have come up with something big. But, you know. But you know what the Lord did? Right away, the Lord said, are you $1,105? And so I told him, I said, you know what? We're looking to start an addictions ministry on Friday night to help reach the addicted in our area. I said, the startup cost for that ministry is $1,105. If you could pay that, then you have that for 6 weeks. He says, you'll have a check this afternoon. And here come the $1,105, and we started Reformers Unanimous. See, that's, I don't want to forget that. See, don't you remember? He was almost grieved at the disciples because they didn't remember what God had done. What he had done in feeding the 5,000 and feeding the 4,000. They had forgotten it so quickly. When the Central Reception Center contacted us and wanted us to bring the RU program to the prison. That was great. We're glad to do that. But guess what? They can't pay for their stuff. Most of you know Cedric come from there, and you know Cedric is just tickled to death. He's working and getting jobs, and he's over. He works in through a temporary agency. He's working a job like afternoons tonight. He's actually working 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. tomorrow morning, but during the daytime, when he's usually not working till afternoons or nights, so he goes over to the campus and he found a guy who just kind of does construction cleanup, and the guy's paying $11 an hour to have somebody help him pick stuff up and take it to the dump. And he said, there's people standing over there at OSU with signs wanting help and wanting food. He said, here's a guy that'll work them free. He said, no, he can't get anybody to work. He can't get anybody to take it because it's only $11 an hour. Cedric said, hey, I'm used to $20 a month. $11 an hour sounds great. Huh? All perspective, isn't it? And so they don't have the money to pay for it. So now we're glad to take it in, glad to help them, but how are we going to finance this? But you know what? God put it on the heart of somebody here. And they came and said, what do you need? And if I remember right, I think it was $3,000 they gave. And we were able to get stocked up on prison materials. And now it's expanded to London. And, you know, frankly, I don't know how we pay for those things. But it just goes. The money comes in and we buy the material and we just keep doing it. It's almost like I'm not asking God a lot of questions. I just say, oh, thank you, and we keep going. I don't know how that happens. The radio program opened up, and man, that's been an amazing thing to me. I'm amazed how many people listen to the radio. And it's amazing the people. How many of you are in church here tonight? You came to the church, or you were influenced by the radio broadcast. Let me see your hand. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? That's amazing to me. And you say, how do you pay for that? I don't know. I mean, we write them a check every month, and there's money to pay for it. God just takes care of it. I don't appeal, if you listen to the program much, I don't appeal to people to send in money very much. It'd be great if they would, but that's not the, I just, you know, God just takes care of it. I don't want to forget that. Did you know, I was thinking today, you don't know, I get the mail. Do you know, we get just a little over $1,000 every month from people who don't even go to church here. They just send an offering in. There's a fella and in town here, I won't mention his name, but runs a business, $100 every week. Every week. Every week. Every week. He never misses. What do we do? I send him an envelope to mail it in with a stamp on it. And we send him tithing envelopes. We say, here you go. We're going to make it easy as you can. And if he's going to support us $100 a week, I'm going to help him. That's God. That's God. See? That's God. We shouldn't forget that. We should not. I don't want us to cower back and be afraid to step forward in faith. And God says, don't you remember what I've done for you? Don't you remember how I provided for you? Don't you remember how I take care of the missionaries and you continue to increase faith promise? Don't you remember how I took care of you with the renovation? Don't you remember how I took care of you with RU? Don't you remember how I provided for the prison ministry? You see, you have another opportunity. We have another opportunity this week with the Faith Promise Missions Conference to increase our faith. To decide, am I going to cower back? I don't know if I can give any more than what I'm getting. I don't see how I can do that. Well, will we go by sight? Or will we go by faith? Will we be willing to say, you know, maybe I wouldn't it be something if God would look down and say, what are you doing? You're trusting me like that? I've not seen so great faith. No, not all in Grove City. Or not in all of Columbus. You see, it'd be great to see God. By the way, God never said He'll honor our sight. He has said He'll honor our faith. And He always honors faith. It pleases Him. Will we go to higher ground in our giving to missions? Will we as a church, will you as an individual, would when you pray about what God would have you do for missions over the next 12 months, would you step out with so great faith and Jesus would look and say, I marvel at that. You think that you're going to step out by faith and Jesus is going to say, whoa, that looks a little steep. Then is anything too hard for the Lord? Will we be willing to step up as a church and say that? Would God look down and say, look at those crazy people? Look at them who were just believing me and trusting me. I told the electricians the other day, one of them was in Chillicothe and was talking about one of the churches down there, I don't remember the name of it, and he just said, but it's so big and you don't know anybody. It's just big screens. And he says, you just come and go. Nobody talks to you or anything. And he said, I kind of like, you know, a smaller church. And I said, you know what? The greatness of a church is not how many they seat, but in how many they send. I told him that. I believe that. We're in the sending business. Glad to send the Morelands. We're honored to send the Yoders. We're honored to send the Perricks. We want to send people out to the harvest field. And I think that's faith. I want God to marvel at us this week and be pleased at what He sees. Now, there's a flip side. Okay? Are you all right? You still with me? Okay? Look at Mark chapter 6. Mark chapter 6. There's a flip side to this. Mark chapter 6. Verse number 1, he went out from thence and came to his own country, and his disciples follow him. When the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were astonished, saying, from whence hath this man these things, and what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works are wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and of Judah and of Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended at him. And Jesus said, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country and among his own kin and in his own house. And he could there do no mighty work, save he laid his hands on a few sick folk and healed them, and he marveled. Jesus marveled at this crowd, but for a totally different reason. He marveled because of their unbelief. He marveled at their unbelief in his very hometown. They wouldn't accept him. They wouldn't believe him. I'd much rather have Jesus marvel at me for my faith than for my unbelief. So I'm going to marvel that I have so great faith and to marvel and shake his head and say, man, I would have liked to have done some great works there, but can't honor your unbelief. Let's not step back, church. Let's not shirk back. Let's step up. Let's not be fearful now. He's either, by this time next Sunday night, he's either going to marvel at our faith or marvel at our unbelief. Let's have him marvel at our faith and not at our unbelief. Let's exercise so great faith so that Jesus will marvel at what we're willing to trust him for. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for these passages recorded for us in the New Testament. Thank you, Lord, that you included this centurion in the healing of his servant and how Jesus marveled at his great faith. But Lord, I'm convicted too when you put in there about Jesus going to his hometown and he had to marvel there. He could not do mighty works there because of their unbelief. And Lord, we know that as we come on to this Faith Promise Missions Week, we'll have opportunity to exercise faith in you. We're going to ask you to put the amount on our heart that we ought to trust you for giving to missions in the next year. And God, we don't want to be fearful. We do want to exercise faith. We would like to trust you. So Lord, help us not to shrink back and not to be fearful and afraid. Help us to remember how you provided for us. And Lord, as you've done it for us as a church, I know you've done it for individuals in this room as well. Individuals could give testimony of how God has provided for them in just miraculous ways. And God, I pray you'd encourage them. We'd like to have you be amazed. We'd like to have you marvel at our faith, not at our unbelief. So help us. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll give the invitation in just a minute. But I wonder tonight as we, and the message was mainly to believers, of course, can I help you know tonight that you don't have to have great faith to be saved? It just takes simple faith. It just takes a little faith in a great Savior. And the great Savior is Jesus Christ. If you've never received Christ as your Savior, I would urge you to receive Him as your Savior tonight. In a moment, I'm going to pray and we'll have our invitation. I'm going to invite folks to come and pray and just ask God. If you can't kneel at the altar, just sit at your seat and pray. But pray and ask God starting tonight, God, what would you have us to do this year for missions? Not what can I see, what do you want me to do by faith? Lord, I want to trust you. You've always provided for me. You've always cared for me. I don't want to doubt you now. I don't want to shrink back. I want you to marvel at me. I want to be like that centurion and have so great faith. When others come to pray, if you're here tonight and you've never received Jesus as your Savior, you don't know what that's all about, you just slip out of your seat and come while they're coming. I'll meet you at the front. We have people who've been trained. They'll take a Bible. They'll show you how you can know Jesus as your Savior. The Lord has spoken to your heart tonight. Let's seek Him. Ask Him what He would have us to do. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening. I trust, God, that you have spoken to people's hearts tonight. And that, Lord, there's a stirring, there's a moving in our heart to want to please God and to want to stretch our faith, to step out, to go to higher ground and to see what you can do in our lives. So, Lord, help us. Hear our prayer tonight and help us to have so great faith. And I'll thank you for what you'll do. And Lord, I pray that a week from tonight we would have rejoicing and victory over what we believe you can do, not just what we can do. Have your way in every heart and life, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. You need to come and pray. You come. Would you please? That's right.
Jesus, I surrender. All to him I freely give.
That's right.
I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior wholly thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all, I surrender. Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power, let thy blessing fall on me.
Sing it with him, will you?
I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Father, I pray that is not just a song we're singing, but a prayer of our heart that we have surrendered all to you. And Lord, I pray you'd help us to live our lives by faith and not by sight. Help us not to give in to our fear, but to embrace the faith that you've given to us. And Lord, as we've seen you do so many, many things and provide in so many different ways, just let us trust you and know that if we'll in all our ways acknowledge you, that you will direct our path. Thank you for how you provide for us and take care of us and provide for us. Lord, help us to continue to keep the getting the gospel out a priority. Reaching people for Christ a priority. Lord, I trust that we'll do what we ought to do, and we know that you will do what only you can do. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for the people who you've brought to this place. Lord, thank you for people that have a heart for you and a desire to please you. Lord, use us now this week and give us a tremendous week. Be with our missionaries as they'll be traveling to head this way this week. prepare them and their heart to minister to us. And Lord, let us be a real source of blessing and encouragement and refreshing to them as they come here to serve among us. Lord, we love you. We ask your blessing now on the moving of the chairs, and I pray the carpeting will go in smoothly the next couple days, and that if you tarry, you're coming, you'll bring us back safely Wednesday night for the service. And we pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. 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 It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. We're going to sing that, and then sit down and look any books you can get out. Get the books out and at least get them on the chairs. And then why don't we have a couple of fellas come through and start collecting books first. Don?
Can I add something about the chairs?
Sure.
Before anybody lifts up the chairs, just reach down and touch the seat. If it's loose and broke, or if that chair has got a rack that's missing, and with your permission, I'd like to send all those all the way to the basement.
Okay.
And yeah, and that, like, around the water fountain area, out in the corner.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. All right. If you're not, and you're not able to carry a chair, don't. Okay. There's stairs involved. If you're a little unsteady, don't do it. Okay. We got plenty of men that can handle it, and they'll do it. Fellas, when you stack them down there, by the way, let's not go any more than four. Okay. Let's not go any higher than four high, so we don't cause any damage to the chairs. Okay. Yes. In this room right over here, stacked up, just on the side against, you know, something out of the way. Don't, you know, so you can still come in and out of the room a little bit. But we should be good with that, okay? All right, let's sing. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus. Anywhere and everywhere I go, for it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You're dismissed.